Welcome to part 6, the last installment of our 6-session mini-series called Everything You Wanted to Know But No One Ever Tells You, 6 Ministry Lessons for Ministry Leaders. And so I hope that you've tuned into each one and you shared it on your social media. And if you're like the rest of us, it might be time to rewind, go back to the first and watch them all back to back and just consider it a whole leadership conference. So today we have saved our most practical, most useful topic for the last, and it's about communication. And there's a saying that the servant team at EdenWestside knows by heart and endeavors to live out daily. And my pastor, the senior pastor of EdenWestside, conference leader, author, and speaker, is going to tell you what it is.
Hey, Steph, what an exciting time it is to be able to come together and talk about these special topics that we've been discussing. And I think your advice is so good to the people that are watching, and that is me, myself. I was just last week, I rewound one of them and went back and thought, man, I needed to hear that. So I really think your advice to them is certainly credible advice to say, hey, you know what, you can pick these up anytime, rewind them, and even use them as a leadership training session wherever people may be. But yeah, today is a hot topic, Steph. It's one of those things that here around our church, we just kind of embrace, and we kind of make that one of the golden rules of our leadership function. And so talking about communication, huh?
Woo-hoo.
What do you think?
All right, Pastor, so tell us what the golden rule of communication is.
All right, the golden rule of communication is little communication is frustration and no communication is failure. Now, let me make sure I kind of elaborate on that a little bit. Have you ever been around somebody or in an organization or been a part of something and you only got a little bit of the information, and when you're looking at it play out, you kind of get frustrated because you didn't get the whole story or you didn't get all the information that you needed? And man, I'm just going to tell you, I've learned in leadership life that if you just get a little bit of the information, it just frustrates you. You know, you want to get the full picture. You want to get the whole story, and you want to communicate effectively and efficiently and thoroughly. And I think that in our lives, and especially in our organizations, we have to really understand, and probably that's something you've never thought about, is that if you just communicate a little bit, it's just frustrating everybody, you know? It's just enough to get them a little frustrated. But then on the other side of the coin, Steph, is that other piece of our golden rule, and that is no communication is failure. Man, when you don't communicate at all, you're just failing as a leader. And I've seen it happen both ways. I've seen leaders that communicated just enough to frustrate everybody, and I've seen leaders that didn't communicate at all, and man, they just failed. So communication is essential in effective leadership, and not just communication, but effective communication. And so as we talk about this today, Steph, I hope and pray that the people that are listening will understand the value of getting communication right. And I'm going to tell you, I'm speaking out of experience, not so much of hitting the home run every time, but certainly striking out every now and then going, man, I blew that one. So I want you to understand, just because we're talking about it doesn't mean we're experts at it, but it does mean that we've learned some valuable lessons along the journey that has helped us get better at what we do.
Well, speaking of lessons, in today's world, there's more than a jillion ways that one can communicate. There's social media, there's text, there's call, there's email, web meetings, in-person meetings. And probably the favorite form of communication for us here at EdenWestside is our weekly servant team meeting, where we put the whole group back in the room and we discuss the comings and goings. And so there's always so much going on at our multi-site church, always events to communicate, things to going on. So kind of first things first, what are some things that you're looking for our servant team to communicate about?
Well, you know, I want to kind of go back and reinforce what Stephanie just said, and that is, you know, we do have multi-site campuses. We have a large group of leadership that's doing a mirage of different things all the time. And so when you look at all that, you have to make sure, man, everybody's on the same page and everybody's looking at the same calendar, and we're kind of making sure that we're fitting everything together. And so I want to talk about that. But before I jump into that, there are a lot of people that I know in churches and even in organizations that may say this, Steph, well, we're just not big enough to go to that time where we have the meeting. Or listen, my friend, you cannot afford not to do that. Even if you don't have a paid staff, you've got volunteer leaders that you need to make sure that you establish a time where everybody comes together and everybody shares information. I've learned, because Eden Westside has not always been the size that we are today. We started off very, very small. But at the same time, we had leaders over different things that we said, hey, let's meet together and talk. And so I just want to encourage you that if you are listening to this session and you're thinking, my, that don't apply to me. Yes, it does. If you're a leader, it really does. Whether you're the pastor of a church, whether you're a CEO of a company, or whether you're a leader over a department or even an event, you need to be able to come together and share that time together. So let's go, Steph, now to the communication process that we use here at our church from the standpoint of where we are at today. First of all, she mentioned the servant meeting that we do every Tuesday morning. Now, here's the thing. You got to establish a consistent time and place to have that meeting. When you're going into looking at your leadership and what you want to do, don't make people wonder, are we going to meet? When are we going to meet? Where are we going to meet? Go ahead on your yearly planning and set those meetings up and communicate it to the appropriate people that need to be there. So as a leader, if you're the leader of whatever you may be leading, make sure that you establish your place, time in your meeting schedule. Go ahead, lock it down, because what you're going to find out is it'll sneak up on you. And you'll think, man, I wanted to meet with everybody, but you know what? I just got busy and time snuck up on me. Don't do that. Be proactive in setting the time, place for your meetings. So what we do is we do it on Tuesday, 8:30. We come together. We have our calendars. You have to look at your calendar. That's very important. So we want to go over our calendars. We want to look at it, our daily schedule. We want to look at our weekly schedule. We want to look at our monthly schedule. And then there is that time when we come together and we do our calendar planning for our yearly schedule. So you've got to make sure that you're coming together. And as redundant as it sounds, you want to make sure that you're communicating in a designated time, designated place, designated meeting with a designated process that everybody can hear the plans, and you communicate it. That keeps a disaster from happening, Stale.
It does.
That keeps a real train wreck from happening. And so I don't know if you want to just kind of marinate on that for a minute, but good night. When you look at it, it just helps everybody, don't you think?
It does. And when you communicate that piece of information in that large group meeting, it helps uncover the gaps that you didn't think about. Oh, I didn't think about that doing this would affect this person over here while I was talking to this person right here. And so it really does help keep everybody on the same page effectively.
Absolutely. And not just that part of it, but there's other parts of it as well. If we don't communicate, person A and person D may be playing the same event in the same place at the same time. And man, you're talking about a mess. You have to learn to share and communicate. And I know that people, when we go into our meeting, they're going, oh, Brother Jackie, not again. We got to open that calendar. Yes, you do. Open your calendar up. We're going to go through it. We're going to talk about it. We're going to make sure everybody's on the same page. Anybody got any questions? So that we eliminate the problem of no communication.
Well, Pastor, when we come together for servant team meetings and other things like that, what kind of information are you hoping that the team will bring? What are the kind of specific things that you're hoping that as we talk through events that people will bring?
Well, I'm hoping that they'll bring to the table their suggested dates. Now, we have to make sure that we all understand that when we're planning something here, that it's not in stone until it's brought to the table and everybody gives a nod on it, because we have to look at the big picture. So we want to make sure that we communicate our dates. We want to communicate our times. We want to communicate what's our place we're going to do it. The place, the time, the event, what is it? What is it all about? And then we have to ask ourselves this question when we're planning things: why are we doing this? It's important, because if you're not careful in your planning, in your communicating, you'll get stuck in a rut of just going, well, we're going to do this again and again and again at this time, all the time, and it may not be working for you. So it's important to talk about that collaboratively so that everybody can have input into it. We're looking for the dates, the location, what's your theme. I mean, it goes forever, Steph. It can be a million different things. How much is it going to cost? How many volunteers are you going to need? How many hours is it going to take? All those things are important. Are you going to interfere with somebody else's activity in this area because you're doing this? Are you going to pull volunteers out from under your plans to accomplish this? Everybody's fighting for help and volunteers, and we've only got this pool to do it in. So we've got to make sure that we're communicating effectively so we don't wear everybody out and everybody's not frustrated. So that's important to do.
Communicating those themes, times, events, locations helps us not have a communication mishap. Another common communication mishap that a lot of leaders experience is what I call the casual passive information.
Ooh.
Or the hallway syndrome.
Oh.
So, Pastor, let's talk about the importance of not communicating in the hallway, but choosing a better way to communicate.
Steph, you just got me itching now. I start breaking out the hives when somebody starts talking about this. You know, one of the worst things you can do to me as a leader is say, I told them. Where'd you tell them? Well, I say I found Joe going to the bathroom, told him we had this going on. And you know what? How terrible is that? You have to make sure. I look at it as a communication circle. You have to tell them, repeat it to them, get them to repeat it back to you, and make that full circle so that it's been thoroughly done. You need to make sure you write it down, you get them an email, you call them, you talk to them in person. Let's just be honest about it. Everybody's too busy. Everybody's too busy. You're passing somebody in the hall, say, hey, by the way, we got this going on. Do you really think they're going to remember that? I mean, do you really think they're going to put that as their high priority of their things to do in their life? Now, it may be important. I'm not saying it's not important. But what I am saying is, don't give people a mind overload by just verbally doing that and passing them in the hall. It's just not going to work for you. And to me, if you're that leader that does that, you're the leader that's doing little communication, and you're frustrating everybody. And they'll say, you know what, nobody told me. And I think that it's so important. You know, there's a lot of venues to communicate. And Steph, I'm just one of those people, I believe you need to use every venue. We're living in a world today that's real media friendly, tech savvy. People say, well, I send everybody an email. Well, you know, I get that, and yes, and certainly you can say, see, I did that. But you know what? That doesn't mean that they looked at it. It doesn't mean that it registered to them. Yeah, you may want to pass them in the hall and say, hey, Bob, we got this coming up. You may want to send them an email. But, man, you may want to write them a letter, call them on the phone, or hem them up, go, hey, we really need you there. Make sure you do more than just nudge them in the hall and tell them. Make sure you do more than just send them an email. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking the same thing that I thought. They're adults. They ought to know. How many times do I have to tell them? Well, you answer that question for yourself, because I'm telling you, if you take on that mindset, that attitude, you're going to fail as a leader. I get it that we're all adults, but man, I'm guilty of forgetting things too. That's why I have an assistant. She's telling me where to go and what to do. But the fact of the matter is, we have to make sure that we go way beyond, Steph, way beyond the hall conversation.
I know for me personally, I try to get as many forms of it as possible.
Absolutely.
So, for example, we had a recent Life Discovery, which is Sunday school or small groups for you guys, adult training. And so on the last page of their packet was our next meeting time. I gave them time in the meeting to stop and put it in their calendar right then, so that hopefully that triggers that electronic reminder later on down the road. They get a letter reminder 2 weeks out, and then the Friday before the meeting on Sunday, they get a text or a phone call from my wonderful assistant who takes great care of me.
I'm just telling you, you have to do it, though.
They get multiple touches, and so it's really helpful. And that helps take the pressure off of me as a leader to be like, oh, did I tell Bob? Did I get Sally? Especially now that we are a multi-site campus, there's no way for me to be in two or three places at one time.
Absolutely.
So it's crucial that we use information as much as possible and as many different touches as we can get.
You know, Steph, looking at that, and I've had to learn this, everybody. It's, you know, I'm talking from past experience and past failures. As much as I wouldn't like to think this way, it is a reality. I'm thinking my box, and my box to me is important, and just so happens that my box is pastoring a church and ministry. And man, I'm thinking everybody ought to be as excited about that as I am, and everybody ought to be in that box, and everybody ought to prioritize that as being the most important thing in their life. But frankly, it's not. You know, they're going to work, they're connecting in different areas, they've got a million different things going on. And so don't kid yourself to think that just because you call a meeting or something you want to communicate, that everybody else is just all jazzed about that, or everybody else has put that at the top of their priority list. And I think what you're saying is so vital, that you use any kind of means of reinforcement of what you're doing as possible.
Well, using a variety of methods to communicate with your team is a great way to have excellent communication with your team. So let's kind of switch gears and let's go the other direction. And so, Pastor, as a pastor, what is excellent communication between your staff members and their pastor? And so as a pastor, what are you looking for us as your servant team to communicate with you, and in what form?
Sure. I that's such a great question, Steph, and it could be from a pastor's perspective or a CEO or whoever it may be. But I think that for me, is taking time to talk. And I think that as simple as that sounds, a lot of what I hear from a lot of people in churches is they don't communicate with me. They don't talk to me. Well, you know, you have to set that time where you talk to people, especially your staff or your organizational leaders. So I think taking time to talk. Now, that I try to do that every day. You know, how are you? Is there anything I can do to help you? How's it going? Hey, you hit a home run the other day. Do you need anything? You know, even though we have our weekly meetings, I still think it's important to take time to talk. And then I think the other part of it, Steph, is having that monthly meeting time that we schedule, where it's not just taking time to talk, but it's in a room in my office that is a deliberate time that's scheduled for each individual staff member to come in and let's focus on your area and talk about your deal specifically. Not in a general group, but specifically about your area. So I think that's important. You have to have a scheduled time with your leaders to give them an opportunity and for you to have an opportunity to be able to focus your communication on them and their box. So I think that's important. So take time to talk, take time to meet individually, take time to meet as a group. We do that once a week. Let me back up. We do the individual meeting once a month. We do the whole group once a week. I try to talk to them every day. And then there's another piece of it that I think is important, and not just take time to talk, but take time to take a walk. And I try to do that. Don't always hit a home run with it, but at least once a week, I want to walk through the building, stop at their office, hang out in their neck of the woods, and just kind of say, hey, I'm here. Let me pray with you. Anything you got going on, take time to take the walk. Take time to take the talk, take time to take the walk, take time to meet, schedule those things. And I think as you do that, there's something to me that happens. Now, this is a nugget for you. And I think that this is something that is so important for you to hear me say. In taking time to talk, taking time to meet together and individually, taking time to take a walk builds a bridge of trust. In order to communicate effectively, you have to trust each other. And your communication here and back has got to be bridged by something. And to me, building that bridge of trust is so important in effective communication. Because if you don't have that trust with an individual, that you feel like they're holding out information, or they're not being transparent, or they're not telling you the truth, or they're not telling you the whole story, man, all of a sudden, I'm telling you, communication is interrupted and there is a problem. And so what I have found in business leadership and in church leadership is you have to build that bridge of trust in order to communicate effectively. If you don't trust me and I don't trust you and you're only giving me part of the story and you're afraid to open up or I'm afraid to tell you this, then we've got a barrier that interrupts our communication. So to me, with our staff, we have to build a bridge of trust. Now, there's something I tell our staff all the time, and that is this. Don't let anything sneak up on me. Don't put me in a place where something sneaks up that you have not communicated that to me. I want to know what I need to know. It's your responsibility to communicate that to me. Now, if they don't trust me or I don't trust them, then there's that barrier. So I think that you need to make sure that in effective leadership, communication is essential. Now, there's a lot of other little pieces that may empower that. Or there's a lot of other little pieces that may interrupt that. But I want to encourage you to constantly and continually working on that bridge of trust so that communication flows. Does that make sense?
Yes. I think it ties back to some of our other series, and that you want to have that meeting that people want to go to because it's going to be filled with positiveness. It's not right. going to be a gripe session. You know, you're not afraid to go to your pastor's office because, oh, he's going to beat me up. If the attitude is always positive,
sure,
then it's an easy way to have that trust. And so it's evaluation, but it's also celebration.
Absolutely. And you know, when you look at communication, you know, as much as we would like to think, even as Steph said there, celebrating and easy communication, man, that's the easy part. There are times when you have to communicate the hard truths. But you don't want to do that publicly. You don't want to do that in a group. You want to do that individually. Don't slam somebody in front of everybody. Get them behind the door and talk openly and honestly and truthfully with them. You know, we try to avoid those conversations as much as we can. But there are times, Steph, when you have to have the hard talk and you have to communicate out of love, but at the same time, you have to communicate truthfully to those people. And you know, that's just part of it as well. But knowing how to communicate in the good times and the rough times is essential for a leader to learn how to do that so they can be successful. And going back to that, I think that also builds that bridge of trust. You know, with all of our people, I'm just, you know, frankly, if they succeed, I succeed. You know, I want to help them be the best they can be, and I want to empower them to do that. I mean, I'm not so dumb that I think, oh, you know what, I can do all this by myself. You can't do it. But you've got to have people that you communicate with, communicate effectively, thoroughly, completely, so that bridge of trust is built, so that everybody knows, you know what? It's not a vindictive communication. It's not a communication to try to hurt you, but it is a communication that's going to be honest, open, truthful, and empowering. And I think that's essential.
I think part of that empowering is just what you're saying, that evaluation, that I trust that Pastor is going to give me, hey, that was great, or hey, we need to work on that, or hey, here's Absolutely. How you could have done that better. That's even part of building the trust. And so, I don't know for you guys, but for me, going for my monthly meeting with Pastor, that's a strategy session. That's a tool to help me become a better leader, which is what we're all about here at Liftoff.
Absolutely. You know, when I was first in the ministry, I had a pastor that was pretty straightforward, and he helped shape me. When I was in the business world, I had CEOs and owners that wanted me to be successful, because if I was successful, they were successful. But at the same time, they would tell me, hey, here's your weaknesses, here's your strengths, this is what you need to polish up on. And now that I look back on that, I'm thankful for that. And I never took offense to that. And I think if you, again, building that bridge of trust allows you to communicate effectively and efficiently. And in doing that, you can talk about the strong points and the weak points, the challenges and the celebrations. But we have to make sure that we know how to do that. A lot of people communicate out of anger or frustration. You know, they wait too long before they talk about it. They let their emotions dictate their communication drive. You don't want to do that. You want to be a leader that's sitting in the leadership pocket so that you're not reacting, but you're acting on your communication style. And as you do that, you're going to find that you're going to get a whole lot more accomplished if you can build the bridge of trust, exercise that communication strategy in a way that's positive, rather than vindictive or angry or frustrated. Don't do all that. Make sure that you're always open and honest. And I think when you do that, you're able to really communicate thoroughly without a question mark or without second guessing or without holding back information. Look, I'd rather just dump the bucket on me so I can process rather than me finding out later on you didn't tell me the whole truth.
Well, there you have it, communication. And speaking of little communication is frustration and no communication is failure, we'd love for you to take this opportunity to communicate with your friends and your colleagues at your church or business and share our Liftoff on your social media page. Also, feel free to access the resources at jcimpact.org. We'd love to see you there. So, thank you for joining us for today's last session of Six Ministry Lessons, Everything You Ever Wanted to Know and No One Ever Told You. We look forward to seeing you again soon.
Yeah, God bless you. Thanks for tuning in. And she did say the last session of these six. It doesn't mean it's the last session. So we'll see you next time.